My name is Jack Kowiak. I want to thank you very much for coming this afternoon to the presentation. I think you'll be very glad that you attended this presentation, because you're going to hear one of the most exciting and dramatic events that ever took place in U.S. history, Doolittle's bombing raid on Tokyo in 1942. And I think it's fitting that we commemorate that event by reliving the events that took place on that fateful day in 1942. So let's start out and look at the story of the Doolittle raid. America's darkest hour. Now, if you stop most people on the street and ask them what was America's darkest hour, especially if it was a younger person, their immediate reply would be the 9/11 attacks. That's probably what they would all say. Well, let's take a look at what they call an alternative history. You've seen those movies like It's a Wonderful Life and other ones where they kind of relive history and give it like another tale. Let's do the same thing for the 9/11 attacks. Now, say for example, after the 9/11 attacks and the war with Iraq started, the initial thing that happened was the shock and awe bombing campaign to basically weaken all the defenses of Iraq. Well, what if, as an alternative history, Iraq was able to source from some foreign power a special technology that allowed them to jam all the signals from the smart bombs and smart missiles? And then we looked at the paper the next day, and it said the U.S. bombing fails. Iraq jams the radio signals. Well, now Syria and Jordan look at this and they say, Iraq's really got something going. Let's join together in a coalition. This is our chance. So basically, we try invading Iraq from the base in Kuwait, but we have no air cover. We can't really use our missile defense. We're going up a much larger coalition than we thought. And all of a sudden, the paper the next day says U.S. forces retreat back into Kuwait. Well, now we're bottled up in Kuwait by this coalition. And the coalition decides it can get more aggressive now, and now some time to go after some of their old enemies. So we pick up the paper again, and the Iraq coalition invades Iran and Turkey. And there's not much we can do about it because we can only fight on so many fronts with the limited force that we have. Well, now this coalition's really going to town. And they figure, well, who's next to go after? Well, logically, they're going to go after Israel. And we try to go in to defend Israel, but basically, without our smart technology, in terms of our missiles and bombs, the fact that we can't fight on multiple fronts and Kuwait stopping them from Turkey moving into other areas in Israel, we're basically forced to abandon defense of Israel. And we wind up having thousands of prisoners taken. Well, you know something? This is pretty much exactly what happened to the United States after Pearl Harbor. You know, people think somehow that after Pearl Harbor, you know, we got sucker punched by the Japanese and we jumped right back up and pummeled them. That did not happen at all. It was just the opposite. We got sucker punched, we jumped back up, and they beat us to a pulp. And this happened for quite a long time. This is a map, and if you look at the yellow line, this is showing the areas that Japan controlled at the time of Pearl Harbor. The red line is 6 months after Pearl Harbor, after we declared war and started engaging them in combat. And if you look, they almost doubled their area of control over this 6 months. We had a string of military defeats that happened. Thousands of U.S. troops were taken prisoners. And we had serious morale problems that were going on, because people basically expected us to fight back after we got surprise attacked in Pearl Harbor. Well, the major concern that the military had on this, besides a public concern, was that if Japan continued to move eastward, and now the Germans were basically moving through the Middle East in their campaign, that they would be able to join up together in a pincer movement. And if they were able to join up together, the military was figuring it'd be incredibly difficult to attack them, because we wouldn't have a strong base of operations. You know, Africa or Australia really isn't, or this area here, isn't a strong base of operations to even attack them from. So this weighed very, very heavily on the commander-in-chief, who at that time, of course, was FDR. And he's sitting back in his wheelchair in the Oval Office behind the desk, and he was really concerned about not one thing, but three things. He was concerned with Japan, the United States, and also Asia. Japan was a juggernaut. Everybody in the world totally underestimated their military prowess. And we just could not stop them, and none of our allies could stop them as well. So we had to build up enough military, because they were much stronger than we were militarily at that point, to basically slow them down somehow before they basically get that pincer movement going. In the United States, the morale effort was suffering greatly. Roosevelt needed to gear up a war economy. He not only had to have people enlist into the services, but he had to change over all of the industry, get the automobile manufacturers producing airplanes, machinery shops producing tanks and other types of ammunitions. So he had to buy time for the U.S. I mean, we could build up a military machine and a military force, but we needed time to do that, and time was running out the way the Japanese was basically running up their string of victories and marching across East Asia to this pincer movement. And the key thing he needed to do with the Asian allies was to build confidence. We did not have the manpower to fight a war on two fronts. We just didn't have enough bodies in the military, even after we had everybody volunteer, to fight a war in Germany and Southeast Asia. So the plan was that we would be supplying equipment to Southeast Asia in terms of tanks, airplanes, and all of that, and we were going to rely upon the Southeast Asians to provide the personnel for the military. I mean, nobody wants to be on the losing side in a war. And there was some concern that the Asians would start switching over to Japan, and we critically needed their support and their personnel to basically execute the war plan. Now, what was the military basically saying? Well, they were saying, look, we just don't have the forces to go against Japan at this stage. So they were proposing, perhaps we could do something with some type of island hopping coming through here, or maybe establish some type of base in Australia to launch an attack there against New Guinea. But Roosevelt wasn't interested in any of that. His major focus was attack the Japanese mainland. He knew the history of Japan, and he understood that they hadn't been attacked in over 1,000 years. And they had supreme confidence and public opinion going through the military that they were totally secure and they could be very aggressive and not have to worry about their homeland. He felt it would be a major psychological blow to the Japanese people and put pressure on their military to slow down their campaign, to give time for the Americans basically to build up their war machine. Well, who did this task fall to? Well, it fell to these people who were basically the brains of the military at that point. Now, most people are familiar with George Marshall, who was the head of the army and also the chief of staff of the entire military. But also, there was General Arnold, who was in charge of what would be the Air Force. There was no Air Force back then. It was called the Army Air Corps. It was part of the Army. And the head of the Navy was Admiral King. And in every meeting that Roosevelt had with these people, the first thing he brought up at every single meeting was, how can we attack the mainland of Japan? And they were sending memos out to all of their staff trying to solicit ideas on how they could do that. And of course, they got a lot of responses back. The British, who we were in big planning sessions with at the Acadia Conference at that time, were saying, well, just do what the Japanese did to you. All you need to do is sneak an aircraft carrier up there to Japan and launch an attack. Well, the problem with that idea is, I mean, we declared war on Japan, so we can't exactly sneak up on them. And also, our military was scattered around quite a bit. I mean, we had military all over on the East Coast, on the West Coast, some in Pearl Harbor. Japanese had a much larger military in terms of Air Force and Sea Force than we had, and they were totally concentrated in a pretty small area here. And the amount of force that they put against this carrier, they could basically wipe it out easily. Not only would they have the naval power to do it, but they could launch at least 80 land-based bombers to just carpet bomb anything like that into oblivion. So this just didn't seem like a practical solution. Roosevelt said, well, how about the Aleutian Islands up there in Alaska? Can't we launch an attack up there? And it was just too far. Unfortunately, if you look at the Japanese-controlled territory, there were no islands we could even stop in to do a refueling there. would make a lot of sense, perhaps, is to launch an attack from the Soviet Union. Unfortunately, at this time, Stalin had a non-aggression pact with Japan. He did not want to fight a war on two fronts, one with Germany and one with Japan. So he didn't want to do anything to offend Japan at this time. Well, the best the military could come up with was this plan of saying, well, if you go into this area of China that's not occupied, we could build an air base here, put a bunch of bombers there, and then we'll build a secret air base in Japanese territory. And what we'll do is fly this to the secret air base, land and refuel, and then from there we could take off and maybe launch something against Japan. The only problem with this plan is it would take 8 months to a year to basically set up these airfields over there, and Roosevelt needed to do something right away. Well, let's get to the next chapter in our story. The nobody and the nerd. Meet Captain Francis Lowe, Mr. Nobody. He was on Admiral King's staff, who was the head of the Navy. And Captain Lowe was low on the totem pole. First off, he was a captain, and everybody else on this staff tended to be admirals in these very high ranks. Secondly, he was part of the submarine corps, and the submarine corps was not a real prestigious thing at that time. And he wasn't even involved in direct warfare. He was involved basically in reconnaissance. So he was the guy that when they had some really important strategic meeting going, you know, they'd send him out for like coffee and sandwiches. And basically, this is what happened in January. They had major strategic sessions going on, war planning sessions going on around the Arcadia Conference with Britain to plan out the whole war strategy. Somebody needed to go over to this naval base in Norfolk, Virginia, to check out the building of this new carrier, the Hornet. Send Lowe, okay? So Lowe gets on a plane and goes out there. And he looks down, and they painted the outline of an aircraft carrier on the airfield. And he saw there were these army bombers, and they were practicing making bombing runs. They were practicing making dive bombing runs. And then he saw one come over and practice strafing across the deck. And he said, wait a second. What if one of those army bombers, medium-range bombers, could take off from an aircraft carrier? Everybody knew that Japan basically set up a defense perimeter of 300 miles around their country. Because a carrier force has to get within 300 miles in order to be within range to launch their planes. Those army bombers had longer ranges than those Navy aircraft. Those army bombers had ranges of in excess of 400 miles. So they could get an aircraft carrier outside the defense perimeter, basically take Japan by surprise, and launch an attack with these army bombers that would get Japan. He was all excited about this. So who did he have to review this with? Admiral King. Now, if you look at this picture, this is about the most that Admiral King ever smiled his entire life. He was not a warm, fuzzy guy. In fact, his staff was definitely afraid of him. It was common knowledge that you never, ever went to see Admiral King by yourself. You went with a group of people for protection. So Admiral King was at these Arcadia conferences all day, and he had to be nice and diplomatic, which was not his nature, so he was grumpy. He missed dinner. It was 8 o'clock at night, and he still had to go back to the command headquarters to do more work. So he comes in all mad, and he's got a headache and all this stuff, and he goes in, rah, rah, and he slams the door to his office, and he goes in there. Well, who comes bounding along? Not much long after that, our hero Captain Lowe. And before anybody could warn him or stop him, Captain Lowe pounds on his door and goes in the office all by himself. And Captain Keene's kind of taken aback because nobody ever comes to see the guy by himself, right? This is the first time. And he says, well, Lowe, what do you want? And Lowe says, well, Admiral King, you know, I had to go to Norfolk, and when I was circling in the plane, they had this outline of this carrier there, and these army bombers were coming down, and they were like practicing these runs. And King just explodes and says, Lowe, what do you want? Get to your point. And Lowe just stammered out, well, if we could launch a medium-range army bomber off a carrier, we could launch outside the Japanese defense perimeter and take them by surprise. And King just glares at Lowe. And then he closed his eyes, and he sat back in his chair, and he did one of these things. And then he said to Lowe, Lowe, I want you to review this with Duncan. And Lowe was like, get out with the going's good. Before he can get to the door, King stops him. And he says, and lo, he says, you're to talk to absolutely no one about this. And Duncan's to talk to absolutely no one about this. And you two are to come back and report to me and me only without talking to anyone. So Lo goes, gets Duncan on the phone to see him first thing in the morning. Well, who the heck is Duncan? Well, do you ever like work at an office someplace and you got some kind of computer problem and none of the techs can fix it? But there's that one guy that sits in the corner of the office, he's got the Star Trek poster, you know, and he's always the guy that could come over and like fix the computer or whatever needs to be done. That was Duncan. He had an encyclopedic knowledge of all things military. And in terms of the command structure, I mean, he was even lower on the totem pole than Lo, but everybody knew to go to him for any kind of an odd question or thing that they didn't know. Wasn't your typical military guy, had a master's degree from Harvard. So Lo knew Duncan, and he said to, you know, Duncan, well, Don, you know, is it possible for us to launch one of these medium-range Army bombers off the deck of a carrier? And right off the top of his head, Duncan goes, well, you know, there's a B-18 and the B-23, but he says the wingspans in those are just too large because you got to be within 80 feet to not hit the island that exists on a carrier. And let's see, the B-26 and B-25 had wingspans that could fit by, but the B-26, the takeoff speed is so fast you never get that off of a carrier. B-25, you might be able to get it off of a carrier, but the problem was it takes too long of a landing distance. And, you know, if you tried to get that little hook, arrestor hook on the thing, basically the Army planes are built different than ours in the tail section, and it just ripped the tail right off the plane. I mean, all you could do was basically, if it was coming back, maybe ditch the plane by the side of the carrier and the pilots would get out and stuff like that. And so Lo was like amazed that he knew all the stuff off the top of his head. And so Lo goes to him, well, what if the B-25s were carrying extra gas and a full bomb load? Duncan said, I don't know, I have to make some calculations on that. So Lo gets in touch with King and they free up Duncan for the rest of the week. And they hold Duncan away in this office all by himself. And he had to figure out something, this big plan, which normally a giant military staff would do, and he had to do this all by himself. He had to figure out the size of the task force, how the bomber would take off, or whether it could take off, the Japanese defense, how to get around that, how to make an impact. And he swirled this around and around and around in his head over 4 days, made all these surreptitious calls and talked to people on the QT. And finally, he came up with a plan. The first thing he looked at was the weather, because he knew his history. He knew back in 1282, when China tried to attack Japan, the last time someone tried to invade Japan, basically their entire fleet was wiped out by a storm. The Japanese call it the divine wind, the kamikaze. That's where that word is from. So he figured, well, he has to wait late enough till the major storms are over, otherwise it could basically upset the fleet, destroy the fleet. But he wanted to not go too late because he wanted enough cloud cover to basically hide the bombers when they were coming in. So he figured mid-April would be an ideal time. The second thing he had to do was do this big trade-off. I mean, the more gas he put on the plane, the longer the range it would have. And the more bombs he could put on the plane, the bigger the impact it would have, so the Japanese couldn't try to cover up the attack with some type of public relations. The trouble is that all added weight to the plane, and then the plane's never going to be able to get off the carrier deck. So he had to do a lot of careful calculations to figure out what the right ratio of all of these things were. He had to look at the task force. These planes were much too big to put on an elevator and store below deck. They'd have to store them all over the deck of the carrier, which meant the carrier would be defenseless. It could not launch any planes in its defense. It couldn't even launch a reconnaissance plane to see if they were basically just going into a big trap. So it would have to be accompanied by another task force that could launch those reconnaissance planes and then be surrounded by supporting ships. Actually, they needed like a task force of 16 ships. 2 carriers, 4 cruisers, 8 destroyers, 2 what they call oilers tankers to refuel them. They also had a couple of submarines. Also, the Japanese defense, which was formidable. I mean, they had 300 anti-aircraft batteries just around Tokyo. And he estimated, in terms of their fighter strength, if they went in with maybe 15, 16 fighters, that basically the 15 or 16 bombers, excuse me, that the Japanese could probably put up about 20 fighters per plane. So it was very, very formidable. So this element of surprise and cover was critical. Well, he wrote this all up on composition paper because he didn't trust anyone to type it because he was supposed to keep the secret. And they went in and they reviewed this with King. And King sat there and he paged through every line of this thing. It's total silence. And finally he looked up and he said, I want you to review this with General Arnold. He was the guy that was head of the Army Air Corps. And if Arnold is receptive, talk to Arnold and only Arnold, no one else. And if Arnold is receptive, then make sure he calls me immediately, not speak to anyone, and let me talk to him first. So they go review this plan with Arnold. And Arnold liked it. And what was the plan? Well, the idea was they would have half the task force leave from San Francisco. They'd go on a meandering path out to about there by Midway, and then they'd be joined by the second half of the task force that would leave from Pearl Harbor. When they joined together, they would go on total radio silence completely. Even between ships, they would only communicate basically through those flashing lights, the semaphore lights. They would proceed to Japan to a point about 400 miles from Japan, where they would then launch the planes. Now, the task force at this point would immediately turn back and go the other way. The planes would proceed to do the bombing raid on Tokyo and two other cities. They would not return to the carrier, because if they returned to the carrier and the fleet, the Japanese could basically follow them right back out there and obliterate that fleet. Instead, they would go the opposite way. They would head to China. And what they could do is put the planes there and start to initiate that plan of building the air base in China as a base to basically attack Japan. The big gamble is our next chapter. Well, one of the things about this is Hap Arnold needed to figure out how to do all of this, because a lot of work needed to be done in terms of plane modifications and training and all this other kind of stuff. It required a very different type of military operation than they've ever conducted before. So he assembled what is considered today to be one of the greatest military staffs that's ever been put together in military history. First, he needed an expert aeronautical engineer, because they had to make modifications not only to hold more gas in these planes, but they were designed as sports cars to outrun these enemy fighters. He had to basically build them as fuel-efficient vehicles to go extremely long distance. He also needed someone that was an expert in low-altitude bombing. Because of the need to catch the Japanese by surprise and not get caught by their radar, the planes were to fly all the way to Japan, it's going to take about 4 hours, at maybe 75 feet from the ground, which is very low. I mean, that's like three stories. That is treetop level. They needed someone that was an expert because they wanted to launch the attack at night. And they were going long distances. So they needed someone that was an expert not only at long distance flying, but night flying by instruments. Okay? Any little problem or deviation, they were going to be way off in their targets. Also, they needed to make these modifications quickly to the plane. They needed someone that could work with these new auto companies that were now aircraft manufacturers to make these things happen. And finally, they needed a crack test pilot that could basically take these planes to their extreme to find out basically if they could perform the way they thought they could. Well, a test pilot was the easiest thing if you're in the Air Force, right? I mean, he got basically a record-setting test pilot. And as far as the aeronautical engineer, he got somebody who was a newly minted PhD in aeronautical engineering from MIT, no less. The low-altitude bombing, he found a guy that was basically a World War I pilot trainer, where they used to do that hedge hopping in World War I and fly real low. He's an expert at that. Long-distance night flying, they got the person that basically pioneered instrument flight, the person that was the very first person to ever take off and land solely on instruments. And the manufacturing liaison, they got the fellow who was responsible basically for coordinating and changing all of the auto industry over to the aircraft manufacturer. And you know something? All those people was just one guy. Because Jimmy Doolittle did all of that stuff. He was a World War I flight instructor. He was a record-setting test pilot. He had a PhD from MIT in aeronautical engineering. He was the guy who coordinated the conversion of the auto industry, and he pioneered instrument flight. Now you say to yourself, why in the world would they risk somebody so valuable on this kind of a mission? Well, actually, he was never supposed to go on the mission. The idea was that he was just going to be a planner. And he kind of tricked himself onto the mission. What he did was he went to General Arnold and he made this big pitch to basically fly on the mission. And, you know, Arnold was this real super nice guy, never liked to say no to anybody. So he said, well, it's okay with me, but you got to clear with my operations officer. So he was going to play good cop, bad cop, and as soon as Doolittle went, he was going to get the operations officer on the phone and say, turn it down. Well, Doolittle figured out what he was going to do. So as soon as he closed the door to Arnold's office, he ran as fast as he could down the hall to the operations officer, opened up the door and said, Arnold said I could go on this mission. Is this okay with you? The guy said, well, okay. And then he closed the door and he heard the phone ring. And the operations officer was saying, but General Arnold, he just said you can go. By the way, remember when King said to Lowe he didn't want him to talk to anyone, keep it totally quiet, and even after he told General Arnold wasn't supposed to speak to anyone, just talk to him? Why was that? Was King basically thought it was a stupid idea and he'd get laughed at if more people knew about it? Or maybe he was kind of a glory hound, he wanted to get all the glory for the Navy? No. King, even though he was a grouch, was a super smart grouch. And when Lowe proposed this, he immediately understood what the true risk of the mission was. It was not to Doolittle and the bombers and the Air Corps. The total risk was to the Navy. He had an idea right away what the task force was, how big it would have to be. And Japan already wiped out a good section of her Navy at Pearl Harbor. If they were sending that many ships over, that was the bulk of what we had left for the Pacific Fleet. And there was a good chance, with the power that Japan had there, that fleet could get totally annihilated. And could you imagine FDR, so many months after Pearl Harbor, having to address the nation, if that got annihilated, the fleet got annihilated, and saying, well, you know, we got this surprise attack from Japan, and they basically destroyed part of our fleet, and then we tried to do this other attack, and unfortunately, they destroyed the bulk of the rest of our fleet. And, you know, we maybe have a carrier or two we could still keep in the Pacific, but they'd have to kind of just defend the west coast of the United States and Pearl Harbor. Unfortunately, it's going to take us years to build up enough naval power for us to launch any type of offensive task force against Japan. So we really can't do anything against Japan after they bomb Pearl Harbor for quite a few years, and we're just going to have to let them go in Southeast Asia and take over at their will. I mean, Jimmy Carter got thrown out of office because a helicopter crashed, right? Well, you know something? The Japanese came this close, and I mean that close, to totally destroying that entire task force. It was only a blind stroke of luck at the last second that saved the task force from destruction. We'll get to that in a bit. Well, believe it or not, up until about a week before the task force set sail on April 1st, these were the only seven people who actually knew the true nature of the mission. They planned the entire thing out. Now, if you look, King had it planned out by Lowe and Duncan. And you say, why in the world would he take these low-level people to do such an important operation? Well, King knew how important the secrecy was to protect the fleet. And he knew that if he put one of his hotshot admirals from his staff on it, it would draw a lot of attention. People would say, oh, so-and-so is working on this. This must be important. But these guys were so low on the totem pole, they wouldn't really gather much attention from anybody. They could work under the cover, so to speak. And they were good at what they did. Actually, Duncan stayed in the Navy for a career, became a rear admiral, was vice chair of the entire Pacific Fleet before he left the service. And they were smart guys. And actually, even FDR wasn't briefed on the total aspects of the raid. Well, they went to Oregon. There's an Air Force there. They had the B-25s, and they confiscated those. And when they confiscated the planes, they said, we might as well ask the pilots that were piloting them if they want to volunteer. And all they told the pilots was the following. It was a hazardous mission. High skill was required, high value to the war effort. And that's all they knew, basically, until they set sail for Japan. They knew nothing more about where they were going or what this was all about. Why did they volunteer? And the whole force basically volunteered, because everybody else was. They didn't want to be left behind. And also, I mean, at that time, the Air Corps was part of the Army. They were losing their planes. They didn't want to get stuck in the artillery infantry or something like that. They wanted to stay in the Air Corps. Let's look at our next chapter. American ingenuity at its best. They had a tremendous amount of work that had to be done inside of 2 months, because we're basically getting into February now, and they had to launch by April 1st. So the planes were taken from Oregon, flown to an aircraft manufacturer in Minnesota, where they were modified, And then they were flown down to Florida, an Elgin Air Force Base, where they did the training. The first thing they had to train were the pilots. They had to teach them, basically, how do you take off of an aircraft carrier. And they had to unlearn, basically, a lot of what they knew before. And you have to kind of understand what makes a plane fly. A plane flies because it gets pushed up from the bottom, okay, from air pressure. And the way you get more air pressure on the bottom is you move air very quickly over the top of the wing, and that lowers the air pressure. Because, like, if you're looking at a weather map and you see a storm system where there's a lot of winds, it's usually low pressure. So if you get a lot of wind over the top of the wing, you get that lift, and it picks the plane up. Well, the way you get that air pressure and air movement is basically the plane starts going quickly down the runway. The faster it goes, the faster it gets the airspeed above the wing. And to take off one of those planes, you needed about 80 miles an hour of airspeed. So it wasn't going to be quite that difficult because the aircraft carrier is moving through the air and it's creating a wind. So they picked the Hornet to do this mission because the Hornet was the fastest carrier in existence, then it can go 25 miles an hour. So if it's going 25 miles an hour, then they only had to basically go rather than 80, but about 55 miles an hour to get the plane. But they had to get a plane that weighed 30,000 pounds from a dead stop up to 55 miles an hour in less than 500 feet. And to do that, they had to totally retrain the pilots in terms of how they did their takeoffs. And Doolittle brought in a Navy pilot that we'll meet later that trained the pilots on how to do this. They also were trained on how to do low altitude flying, how to fly on instruments at night for extensive amounts of time. The navigators basically had to be trained in, because they're taking all of the radios out of the plane, they were too heavy to save weight, 230 pounds, so they basically were training them how to use sextants and other types of things to navigate. The other thing that had to be done was they had to change this sports car, because the bomber was designed basically to go real fast and outrun the fighter planes. They had to change into a fuel-efficient vehicle. And they do it the same way they do it with cars today. First off, they tried to strip out a lot of weight on it. They took out all kinds of armament and all kinds of other things in the plane. They retuned all the engines and all the carburetors and kind of redesigned them to make them much more lean in the way they operated. And they doubled the amount of fuel that was on the plane. Normally a plane has wing tanks, two wing tanks on either side. They put a big fuel tank here. They took out this rear turret so they can make room for another gas tank. They took out all the guns in the back. And they put another gas tank over here. And there's a crawl space here. And what they did is they took a big rubber gas tank like a bladder and they filled it up with gasoline with the idea that as the gas went out, they'd take out the bladder so the guy back there can get to the front of the plane. And then to top it off, they figured out all these nooks and crannies where they could jam in about 15 5-gallon gas cans and stick them all over the plane. And the guy in the back of the plane was to keep putting gas into the gas tank as they went. Now, one of the problems was armament. And they took a lot of the guns out of the plane, especially all of the ones that were in the bottom of the plane, which is a problem. They still had the turret on top. But when a fighter comes to attack a plane, a bomber, the way they generally attack is up from beneath like this. That's where they're most vulnerable. So they said, well, what are they going to do? Well, they took all the guns out, and they didn't want the weight there. So the guy had an idea by the name of Greening. He says, hey, get those brooms. They got a bunch of brooms, and they cut off the broomsticks. They took the broomsticks, and they painted them black, and they stuck two broomsticks out of the back of the plane to make it look like there were machine guns there to fool the Japanese. And then they joined a bunch of hydraulics in this turret on top to make it fast to turn to basically defend the plane. The other issue had is they could not take the Norton bomb site with them. That was the super secret bomb site. They could not risk that having fallen into enemy hands on such a risky mission. So another fellow designed what's called the Mark Twain bomb site, which is that thing right there. Sometimes they call it the 75-cent bomb site because it took 75 cents worth of materials to develop. But the way it works is that if you want to bomb something and you're going at a high elevation, when you release the bomb is traveling at about 200 miles per hour, the speed of the plane. So if you're really high and you release the bomb, it is traveling 200 miles an hour until it reaches the ground. So if you're high and you want to hit something that's, oh, say over there, you have to release way over here to hit that point. If you're traveling at a lower altitude, the bomb's going to hit sooner, so basically you could release the bomb closer to the target. Well, this guy came up with this site, and he basically gave the bombardiers this little table. And it said, if you're going this high and at this speed, set this thing at this number. Look through the bomb site, and as soon as you see your target in this little area of the bomb site, let go of the bomb. And they tested this thing at low altitude bombing, and it turned out to be more accurate than the expensive Norton bomb site. As a matter of fact, it was used for the rest of the war for low altitude bombing. Time to get on your horse. That was the code word they gave to Doolittle that meant to say, we're ready. You got to stop the training, get these planes over to San Francisco. So they loaded up the planes and they basically practiced the low altitude flying, and they basically went to an air base in Alameda, California, where basically they were going to test out all these modifications to the planes, see if they were working okay before they got to San Francisco. And it was a mess over there. Basically what happened is there were a bunch of civilian mechanics there. They weren't in any hurry to fix anything on the planes, and Doolittle couldn't tell them anything about the mission. And also, they kept reversing all these modifications they made to the planes. They kept looking at it and saying, well, this is out of spec, and they kept retuning the carburetors and doing all of this stuff, and it was just a nightmare. So when Doolittle was there, he had an episode that I'll read you from Glean's book on Doolittle. When Doolittle arrived at the base and made out his flight plan for the short hop back up to San Francisco, he was handed a report to fill out, which asked for his opinion of the work that was performed on the planes while at this Alameda, California station. He took one look at it and wrote diagonally across the form a single word, lousy. The base operations officer looked startled when he saw the remark. Just a minute, Colonel. You will have to give me a detailed report. This simply will not do. I haven't got time, Doolittle snorted as he turned and headed for his B-25. I won't sign your clearance then, Colonel, the young officer called after the disappearing Doolittle. He stared in disbelief as the man climbed into his airplane and started his engines and took off. The infuriated operations officer turned to one of Doolittle's pilots and shouted, who does this guy think he is? I can tell you, he's headed for a lot of trouble. His pilot laughed and said, he sure is, he sure is. Well, when they got to San Francisco and they had to load up the carrier, you can see how tightly stacked those planes were on the carrier. They barely fit on the plane. And they had to lash them down very, very securely. Now, the pilots basically spent most of their time to themselves, basically watching their planes, because they didn't trust the Navy mechanics to start tampering with them again, like happened in California. And the other thing they kept doing was pacing up and down on this line here. This was supposed to be the line they were followed on takeoff. As you can see, this is where the side wheel is, and this is the center wheel. It's quite close to the edge. Not all the space they had on this big runway in California. Also, it wasn't this nice, dry concrete pavement. It was this deck, wooden deck, that was kind of slippery. And not only that, is when they paced off the distance, it turned out it wasn't 500 feet, it was only 427 feet. And they were barely making the 500 feet when they were taking off over there in Florida. So they were getting worried about this. And actually the planes, the way it worked was, it wasn't like if the planes took off in front, the ones in the back had more space. They had to take all the planes off from in front of this island that was on the carrier, because they could not risk having one of these planes slip or fishtail and hit into that island that would disable the carrier right outside Japan. So they had to take off in front. They would all have to take off from that short distance. Well, things were getting a little tense on board the carrier between the Navy and the Air Force and Air Corps people. And so Captain Michener, who was head of the carrier, captain of the carrier, basically announced about a day into the voyage, he just sent a signal over the loudspeaker that said, the destination of this task force is Tokyo. And everybody understood what that meant. And basically, everybody joined together in a joint effort. Now, one of the big things that Michener arranged was, along with Doolittle, was training for the crew while they were there to keep them busy, Doolittle's pilots. And some of that was with Hank Miller. He was the naval pilot who was down there in Florida helping them train. He came back aboard the carrier. And he worked extensively with the pilots, along with some other intelligence officers, on the bombing sites. And they were very, very careful when they picked out all of these bombing sites to do just military and industrial targets. They did not want any bad public relations from this bombing raid where they would hit a civilian target. Especially they didn't want to actually hit the Emperor's Palace or do anything to that. They thought that might alienate their Asian allies, that they needed to go along with the raid. A key person in all of this training was Lieutenant Commander Stephen Jurica. He was born in the Philippines, but he was raised most of his life in Japan and China. And actually, just before this, through 1939 and 1940, he was in Tokyo. He was stationed there as a liaison officer. And part of his responsibility was to scout, basically, sites for military targets. So he knew Tokyo and these cities like the back of the hand. Now, he also instructed them in a lot of other things in case they were taken down behind enemy lines in China. He basically taught them things like, well, if you come upon somebody, how do you recognize a Japanese from a Chinese? The difference between getting killed and being saved. So he basically taught them to recognize the facial features. He taught them little tricks, like when you say hello, if somebody smiles and nods their head, they're Japanese. If they smile and bow, they're Chinese. He gave them basically a phrase to learn in Chinese that meant basically, I'm an American. He told them all, if they get somebody and they can't communicate, draw a picture of a train. Because there's only one railroad track and it goes to the destination of where you need to go. He warned them about any kind of cuts or nicks they can get. Because in that area of China, rural China, they had something called night soil. If anybody's familiar with that. But basically at that time, the Chinese used human waste as fertilizer. And through many, many generations, they developed an immunity to all the bacteria. But if anybody else goes there and basically gets cut, they get severe infections. Well, in the meantime, Doolittle had meetings before they set sail and after with the command structure. Nimitz was in charge of all naval operations, and Halsey was in charge of that particular task force. He was on the Enterprise, actually, or the carrier. And what would they do in terms of the plan to take off? Now, ideally, they were going to get within 400 miles, okay? If they got further out than that, say 550 miles, okay, they would reach Japan, but they'd probably land in enemy territory. If they got out to maybe about 650 miles, they probably wouldn't even be able to make the coast of China. They'd have to ditch it, and it would be a suicide mission. So that was kind of the guideline. 400 miles, ideally, 650 miles, basically, it's you couldn't even reach China with the planes. Well, the plan was that they were going to fly this mission on Saturday night, actually Sunday morning, very early in the morning. What happened was the day before, they were going to fly the mission on Sunday evening, at sunset, and take off at sunset for the night mission. What happened was on Saturday evening, which would be early Saturday morning, about 3 a.m., they started encountering enemy ships. And not one, but more than one. And finally, daylight broke, and they were still encountering enemy ships. And there was a ship out there that they could see it, they know it could see them. So they basically tried to take the ship out. So they launched basically their attack planes. The attack planes couldn't sink the ship. They put all the ship batteries on it, and believe it or not, they fired like 928 shells at the ship before they could sink the thing. A variety of mishaps. There was a rookie crew and a bunch of things went wrong. At any rate, by the time they sunk that ship, a half hour later, they intercepted radio signals that it was sending out to Japan, basically telling everybody about the fleet. So Doolittle was sitting there with Michener in the bridge of the cabin, watching this at 8 o'clock in the morning, sipping coffee. And all of a sudden, they looked over at the Enterprise, and the worst case scenario happened. They looked at the Enterprise, and then the lights started flashing from the Enterprise. And then this message started being come across from the Enterprise. At this point, they were 650 miles out. Now, the Enterprise would get closer before they could launch, but not much closer. So Doolittle basically said, gotta go, right? He goes down to where the men's quarters are. He tells everybody he can see, we're going now, okay? And of course, a lot of the Air Force people were basically, a lot of the pilots were sleeping late because they were going to fly a night mission. So they were sleeping, so they're jumping all over the place, what's going on? And there was this bedlam, basically, to get going. On top of that, there was this horrific storm taking place. And I mean a horrific storm. Normally, they would never, ever even launch Navy planes in this thing, let alone these heavily loaded bombers. The swells from this storm were so large. You know, this aircraft carrier, the difference between the deck and the waterline, 70 feet. The carrier was pitching so much, believe it or not, waves were actually breaking over the top of the carrier deck. That's how high the waves were. So the pilots are out there in this terrific storm, and they couldn't even walk to the planes. They had to basically kind of crawl with their equipment because they were sliding all over the deck. It was so dangerous, one of the Navy crewmen that was preparing the planes, a gust of wind hit them because the wind was blowing a steady wind about 30 miles an hour, and they had gusts stronger than that. It shot him like he was on ice skates across the slippery deck, and he went into the propeller of one of the planes behind him and took his arm off. He's lucky he didn't get killed, actually. Incredibly dangerous. So Doolittle basically gave several chances during this whole training operation to have people get out of the mission if he wanted to. And he knew what the big problem was. They were maybe 620 miles out at this point, but they had this big headwind to go against, and that was going to chew up all of their gasoline. And he basically said to them, I think it's just about impossible that we're going to be able to reach the China coast. And this looks like a suicide mission. Anybody that wants to leave can leave. We have extra pilots that can take your place. Nobody left. Everybody went. And of course, when they went back on the planes and the navigators did their calculations, they saw that was accurate. There was no way they were going to be able to reach the coast of China. Well, that's an actual picture from one of the destroyers of the Enterprise. And you can see how big a plane that is coming off of such a small ship, and you can see what the seas were like. Well, what happened with these launches? Well, Doolittle was the first up, and since he was the greatest pilot, he was considered the greatest pilot of the 20th century, actually. The idea was, if he can't get off the deck, nobody is, okay? So he gets in there, and he's cool as a cucumber because he was an experienced test pilot. And he looked at his wind gauge, and the wind's blowing at like 30 miles an hour. And he said, well, wait a second, carrier's going 25 miles an hour. The wind's at 30, that's 55 miles an hour. I get this plane going 25, 30 miles an hour, I'm off the deck. So the flagman, whose name is Osborne, he's the guy with the flag that basically signals the planes to go off. He didn't know what to do because the deck was pitching up and down and up and down like this. And he has to time it because if he releases the plane when it's going down, it'll basically go at this incredibly high speed straight into the water and just get obliterated, okay? He has to time it somehow so the plane is coming level or up in the air. Okay, hopefully like level, so if he's wrong, at least there's some kind of like error there that he can get the plane up. So he takes a guess, the best guess, because he never saw anything like this flying off a duck before. And Doolittle comes out of the chute, and he winds up fishtailing all over the deck. And one of the Navy pilots in the control tower just yelled out, this guy's not going to make it. But then all of a sudden, Doolittle straightened out, and after a short distance, he got off the deck with some room to spare. And at the point he left, actually the carrier deck was like all the way tilted. So when the crew looked at the plane, it actually looked like it was going straight up in the air. And he leveled out and he came this way. Now Doolittle had to basically fly over the aircraft again to set his compass. They held up a big sign to regalopate the compass. So he flew over the deck and everybody knew Doolittle was off and the mission was on. Well, next in line was Hoover. Now, they were supposed to line up the pilots with the best ones were first, and then the ones that weren't as good were later, so they could learn from the mistakes. They couldn't get the planes on the way they thought. Hoover was not one of the best pilots. He was a kid in college 6 months ago, and basically he came out of college, they sent him through this flight training school. He's sitting there on this deck that's pitching up and down. He can't even see the end of the runway. the train is coming so hard, saying to himself, what am I doing here, right? The flagman's looking at him and saying, this guy is in Doolittle, okay? If he's ever going to get off the deck, I got to time it and risk it. So he's going to come up on the upswing. So he gives the flag signal. Hoover comes racing down the runway, gets off, not with very much room to spare, and gets off at the very peak. And Osborne timed it right. And the plane basically came up, just like Doolittle did, straight into the air. But rather than leveling out like Doolittle did, he kind of panicked and he gunned it like a fighter pilot. Which is fine if you've got a small fighter plane, but if you've got a bomber waved down with 30,000 pounds of bombs and fuel, it doesn't work. And the plane stalled. And Hoover dropped like a rock. And he went down and he fell below the waterline or the deck line of the deck, and everybody basically braced for when the carrier hit the plane and obliterated it. And all of a sudden, Hoover's plane appeared before the deck and it was flying. And everybody was like, hooray! Hoover got his wits about him. And after the plane stalled, he did what wouldn't have been instinctive, but what a really good pilot would have did. He hit the throttle and he accelerated straight into the water. And that built up the wind speed. It created the storm over the wings that lowered the aircraft. And he got the lift and he came up. And as a matter of fact, as bombardier said, he swore he could have reached out that window and touched the water. They got that close. And he pulled the plane out. Ironically, after that, he was the only guy who had a wheels-up landing later on. The third guy off was Gray, who was a good pilot. But after what he witnessed, he wasn't exactly bubbling with confidence. Now, Hank Miller, the guy that was a Navy pilot, he had a big blackboard. And he was waving, and he's shouting at Gray to get his attention. And he did, and he wrote on the blackboard these instructions. It had to do with stabilizers and stuff. But basically, it was, don't do what Hoover just did. Okay? And Gray did, and he gets off the deck. And actually, the other pilots got off the deck barely. And I mean barely. Let's take a look at some footage I have. You can see a plane coming off the deck. He's going up, going up, going up. Whoa, 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 whoa. He's losing, he's losing, he's losing. He's coming back, he's coming back, he's coming back. That was typical of most of the takeoffs. Here's another guy, you watch him. He runs it to the very end of the deck. I mean, he must have had just a couple of feet left before he gets this thing off the ground. Just at the end of the deck. And this guy, I think he does a decent, he has a little problem getting elevation, but at least he kind of holds it a little bit. And then you'll see another picture here of one of the destroyers, and I'll give you an idea of what the seas were actually like that day. That's how bad it was out there.
Where'd you get these pictures from?
This is from the National Archive. Now, the other thing I want to show you, this is from 30 Seconds Over Tokyo. I want to play you this clip. It's one of the more accurate war movies that's ever been done. So they're flying so low at 75 feet. Looking for those Japanese fighters, 20 to 1 against each plane.
smokestack. Pilot to Bombardier, approaching Smyrna.
See the bomb site?
We've got our altitude.
Cluster incendiary bombs, the first time they were ever used. Didn't the Japanese fighters attack them? What was going on? No, the Japanese could see them. The Japanese fighters could see them.
Yeah, but they hit some of their civilians.
No. What was going on in Japan? Well, actually, the Japanese knew they were coming all along. They went on radio silence. Remember I showed you once the fleet joined together? Well, it turned out that the Japanese could pick up radio communications much further than the Americans ever thought. And before the fleets joined together, they intercepted the communications, knowing there were two big fleets headed their way. Those ships that basically they spotted early in the morning, that basically gave them away, what they didn't know is that Japanese was worried, because they had such a big PR campaign to their people, that they were invincible and they'd never get attacked. They decided to set up a defense perimeter of 700 miles around their islands, and they basically confiscated all these fishing boats. They had thousands and thousands of them in Japan. So they confiscated a whole bunch of them and they put radios on it. So when our subs and reconnaissance thought, they just thought it was a fishing boat. They were actually picket boats set up there to radio in. So they knew they were coming. But the Japanese plan was, they didn't want to upset the Japanese people. I mean, they had this big PR campaign that they were invincible. So their plan was, they had plenty of time. They called in all of their fleets from India and all over, and they had this huge armada there. They had six carriers there. There were battleships, destroyers. They called in all of their bombers and planes ready to obliterate that task force. So the idea was, once the picket line sighted them and they got them sighted by the picket line, they could pretty much estimate when they would get within 300 miles to launch their planes. And at that point, when they had the planes on the deck, they were going to send their big armada after it, destroy the task force, and then come back as heroes to the people of Japan. But they didn't launch the plane at 300 miles. They launched the plane at 400 miles. They thought they were coming the next day. They came the day before. Now, that day, that whole week, as a matter of fact, was planning for celebration of the emperor's birthday. And they were going to show off, basically, Japan's air power to the emperor. So they had all of these planes flying over Tokyo over that week, all these strange planes that nobody saw before. So when a lot of people saw those planes coming in really low, they thought it was just a new Japanese plane and they were cheering. On top of that, they just happened to have an air raid a few hours before the attack. So everybody assumed it was part of that air raid. When they did the attack, they came in all different sides of the city to fool the Japanese into thinking it was a larger force that was hitting them. And with the cluster incendiary bombs that we're using, it created a large number of hits and fires. So the Japanese thought they were under attack by a very, very large squadron. So when they launched all of their fighters, their orders were to find the large American squadron, destroy it, or follow it back to the fleet so we could find where they are, that task force, and destroy it. So when they saw Doolittle's planes down there, they weren't interested in one little rogue plane that wasn't even going east back to the fleet. They were going some other direction. They wanted to find the big squadron that never existed. Okay? So they knew the fleet was out there, right? And they couldn't find it. They had this armada. So the general that was in charge took every reconnaissance plane he had in Japan, and he sent them out looking for that task force that turned around. And the people on the task force could hear the reconnaissance planes approaching and coming overhead, but they couldn't see them. You know that crazy storm? It followed the task force out to sea. It was a highly unusual weather front in that it had this thick, low cloud cover like a blanket. And the people on the task force could hear the planes above them, but the reconnaissance pilots couldn't see anything. And they were incredibly frustrated. They were staying out well past their fuel limits. The general actually sent them out for 4 days straight. He was tearing his hair out trying to find this task force that he was all set to obliterate it, and he couldn't see it. He couldn't find it. And the storm basically saved the task force. Now, what happened to the pilots? Okay, they're running out of fuel. Well, that same crazy storm, the weather system kind of turned around in a cyclone fashion like it did, and where they had a headwind before, once they did the bombing, all of a sudden they had this strong tailwind. And that tailwind was enough, basically, to give them the boost they needed to reach the coast of China, that they did not crash in the sea. Otherwise, they're trying to make plans to ditch a plane by another ship or something like that. And they landed all over China in enemy territory. Now, two of the planes' crews, when they parachuted out, were captured by the Japanese. And there were 7 casualties from the raid. 3 of the men were executed. 1 of them died as a POW. 2 of them drowned. There was another guy on crew 3 that drowned as well when he parachuted out. Caused a lot of outrage in the United States when those prisoners were executed against the Geneva Convention. Crew number 8, they had one of these planes. They didn't know it, but they basically changed their carburetor in California. And so they went through just about all their fuel when they got to Japan. And they had no chance. So they decided they were just going to go over to Russia and land. It was close. They'll take their chances. So they landed there, and they basically, the Russians didn't know what to do with them. They didn't want to offend the Americans, and they didn't want to offend the Japanese. So they stayed there as quasi-prisoners, quasi-guests of the Kremlin. And they basically had this daring escape where they moved them to Iran, and they found some Confederate that took them through all these kind of escapades to basically break free and go to the border and get out of Russia. And the guy came after the war and he wrote this famous book called Guest of the Kremlin about all his escapades. Well, when the Iron Curtain came down a few years ago, they found out that the real story was this person, this guy who helped them basically to safety, was a KGB agent the whole time. The Russians wanted to get out of this political mess, so they figured the best thing to do was have the Americans escape, and so they helped them escape by having this guy take them out. I mentioned this particular crew. We do have a Western New York representative. There was a fellow from Gowanda, New York, that was part of the crew. This particular fellow was interesting. There were actually 3 or 4 different pilots that went on to other missions and became German POWs. This fellow actually was a POW that was part of The Great Escape. Remember the movie, The Great Escape? It was based on an actual incident. He was one of those POWs that actually was involved with that as well. The Chinese just did yeoman's effort, all these peasants, to save the Doolittle crews. They hid them in these caves against these Japanese onslaughts, because they were combing the area. They wanted these Doolittle pilots. The Japanese were all over. They hid them and moved them all over the country in rickshaws and carrying sleighs and all over. And here's a crew, this is a guy by the name of McElroy, holding their parasol. And I'll read you a little excerpt of what they experienced. They were being ferried basically through the country by this Captain Wong of the Chinese Army. Well, with Captain Wong, we arrived outside of Pyongyang late in the afternoon. There, we were stopped right outside the gates of the city for close to 2 hours and had to wait. And we gave us no explanation on what was going on. We could hear strange noises ahead growing louder. A procession wound out from the houses of Poyang, a city of some 300,000. At the head was a man in the first decent army uniform we'd seen in China. He turned out to be Brigadier Zhou. He was a general. Behind him was an 8-piece band with these strange instruments, and they were creating these really weird noises. The general welcomed us and told us to fall in behind. The procession moved back into the city. Then we could see why there was a delay. From virtually every house fluttered a banner saying in English, "Welcome, brave American flyers, first bomb Tokyo.
United States, and China rule the Pacific. Under the words were Chinese character, which Mr. Wong said repeated the message in Chinese. The streets were lined with enthusiastic Chinese who threw firecrackers as we marched up and down the streets for miles and miles. It grew dark, but we still marched. After a couple hours, we finally recognized the noises that the band was making. It was the band's idea of the Canadian national anthem. It was the only non-Chinese song they knew, and they thought it was close enough, and they played it over and over and over again. How about our hero Doolittle? What happened to him? Well, he parachuted out of his plane and landed in a rice paddy. And so there was a hut in the distance, so he went over to the hut, and he banged on the hut door, and he said his word in, you know, Chinese, "We are Americans." And basically, the lights went out, and he heard the bolts slam. So he went down the road, and it was raining, and he saw this big box there, and he climbed in to get out of the rain, and he found out it was a big coffin with their bodies in there. So he got out of there. And then he came across a peasant, and he drew a picture of a train for him, and the peasant nodded, and he took them into a Chinese military encampment. Now, they didn't speak English very much. They didn't know who Doolittle was. They never saw an American before. So Doolittle tried to signal he was a pilot. They didn't trust him. They wanted to take his gun away. Doolittle wanted to get it. So they went back to the rice paddy, and Doolittle was supposed to show him the parachute to prove that he was who he said he was. Well, they go back to the rice paddy, and the parachute wasn't there. And Doolittle said, "Well, go knock on the hut. They'll tell you, you know." They heard the plane and, you know, knocked on the door. And the people from the hut come to the door and said, "Nobody knocked on our door last night. We didn't see anybody. We didn't see any parachute. We didn't hear any planes." And the Chinese general basically said, "You lied. I mean, you're a spy." And basically, the two guys raised the machine guns. The Chinese general took his gun. Doolittle started going for his gun. And just then, two Chinese soldiers walked out of the hut with the parachute. The farmer was hiding it. He wanted to make it into something else. So he was reunited with his crew. And one of the people that basically helped them escape was John Birch. Exact same John Birch that the John Birch Society was named after. He was a missionary in China at this time. And I'll read you another story about Doolittle. When he was walking, he basically got extremely tired because they were walking a long distance, and he had basically hurt his ankles. He broke them before in the parachute thing. So he asked the one Chinese person who spoke English if he could get some kind of transportation. And the officer said, "I'll see if I could find a donkey for you to ride. You just wait here." The Chinese officer went off to a nearby village and returned in about 30 minutes, leading a stubborn little donkey. "Here, you ride this donkey," he offered. Doolittle, ready for anything, walked around the rear of the animal to mount. Just as he passed the south quarter of the donkey kicked him savagely in the chest, sending him sprawling down the trail. The colonel sat gasping for a few moments and held his injured chest. The little officer, Chinese officer, watched the scene complacently, then walked over to the colonel and said, "He bites, too." One of the most famous pictures of the Doolittle raid is this one. It's Doolittle sitting outside the wing of his plane. Doolittle felt that the raid was a total failure. He lost the planes that he was supposed to send to China. He didn't know if he lost his crew. Maybe they were all dead and he was the only survivor. So here's a section from Doolittle's biography. "As I sat there, Paul Leonard, who was his crew chief, took my picture and then, seeing how badly I felt, tried to cheer me up. He asked, 'What do you think will happen when you go home, Colonel?' I answered, 'Well, I guess I'll court-martial me and then send me to prison at Fort Leavenworth.' And his crew chief said, 'No, sir, I'll tell you what will happen. They're going to make you a general.' I smiled weakly and he tried again. 'And they're going to give you the Congressional Medal of Honor.' I smiled again. He made one final effort. 'Colonel, they're going to give you another airplane, and when they do, I'd like to fly with you as their crew chief.'" Well, actually, all those three things came true within a few weeks. Doolittle was promoted to a general. He was seen as a hero. He accepted a Congressional Medal of Honor on behalf of the crew, and that guy became his crew chief in South Africa, where he basically led a squadron after that. What was the aftermath of the Doolittle raid? Well, we talked about those three spheres, remember, that FDR was worried about? Well, Japan, it was total panic. I mean, there was enough damage done with these fires that the whole population knew they had been attacked after the military had this big PR campaign telling them they were secure. The military was in a panic. They didn't really know where the planes came from. Nobody actually saw the fleet. So some people in the military said, "No, you couldn't take a plane off a carrier like that. It had to be more of a super long-range technology to develop, and the planes were launched from the Aleutian Islands or Midway or someplace like that." Yamamoto, who was very conservative up to that point, basically felt he lost tremendous face with this attack on Japan. He wanted to recruit face. So he basically decided to totally change his philosophy on the war, and he said, we totally have to expand our basically defense perimeter. And we have to expand and take a gamble to basically seize a bunch of islands to be secure. And the target was Midway. And anybody that's familiar with World War II history knows he took a huge gamble that blew up in his face. The Japanese lost the bulk of their carrier force, and it was seen as the turning point in World War II. And they didn't really understand how important the Doolittle Raid was until well after the war, and Japanese historians basically come out with what was going on with the military. Even when I was in school, I could remember learning that basically the Doolittle Raid was important from a PR camp standpoint, but militarily was minor. No, the Doolittle Raid was the keystone to actually winning the whole war in the Pacific. American public, of course, they were jubilant. FDR basically, you know, bragged about the success of the raid. He didn't say how it was done. He just said that planes were launched from our secret base in Shangri-La, he said. And the original name of Camp David was Shangri-La. That's what he called it in honor of the Doolittle Raid. And later, Eisenhower changed it to Camp David. Now, the people who did suffer greatly because of the Doolittle Raid was actually the Chinese peasants. The Japanese came in later and massacred that summer over 250,000 Chinese peasants in a brutal way. I mean, their standard procedure would be they'd go into some kind of a family, they'd take the female head of the family, make the family wrap her in blankets, put lamp oil all over it, and set it up like a human torch, and then kill the rest of the family. Just brutal massacres. Despite those massacres, the Chinese peasants went on to save an additional 100 pilots during the war. They don't get the credit they deserve for the help that they gave the Allies and the Americans during the war. I mean, they get a lot of publicity to the French resistance. They had grease guns and radios. These peasants had nothing but an awful lot of moxie to help the Americans. What made the raid a success? Well, courage, obviously the crews. They went on a suicide mission. And the Chinese people, let's not forget those Chinese peasants. Ingenuity, look at all the things that were invented. You know, they actually invented a cruise control that went into planes that were used afterwards to conserve fuel. They figured out how to redesign all these carburetors for longer range bombing missions, which were used over Europe later. They designed this new bombing site, the cluster incendiary bombs. And even those broomsticks, they worked. Because when they interviewed the Japanese pilots after the war, they said when they came behind the plane, they thought there were machine guns there. And they came up on top and they didn't attack the planes from below. And the pilots basically were able to outrun them at that point. Cooperation. This is the first time in history they did a joint Army-Navy cooperation. And these two are very competing services. They normally would not trust each other. And it's a lesson our politicians could learn today about how to work together and accomplish something. And finally, luck. If it wasn't for the storm, the pilots never would have got off the deck with that tilt. If it wasn't for the tailwind of the storm, the pilots never would have reached the coast. If it wasn't for the storm, that task force would have been totally destroyed. It was the American divine wind, the American kamikaze. Thank you very much for attending my presentation. I'll be happy to answer any questions at this time.
How many planes, how many crew, and how many survived?
They actually trained 24, is what they trained. The plan was they could only fit 15 on the deck. They wound up squeezing one more plane on 16, a 16th plane. And the idea was, Doolittle talked them into squeezing on that plane because he says, let's have Hank Miller, the Navy pilot, fly it off just to show people it could be done, and they'll fly back to the West Coast.
16 planes.
So it was 16 planes. They never flew that 16th one off as a test flight because they thought it might give them away if a spy saw it on the West Coast. In terms of survived, everyone survived except 7 pilots. That mission. But a lot of the pilots were killed in later episodes.
Plane?
5. Crew of 5. Pilot, co-pilot, navigator, engineer, flight engineer, and gunner.
Did he even have any gunners?
No gunners. Just the turret guy on top. Matter of fact, in the movie 30 Seconds Over Tokyo, that gunner that was there, who was on Ted Lawson's plane, he was one of the two people that won a Silver Star during the mission.
What was the response in America after the news of the Doolittle Raid came out? Was it still somewhat secretive, or did they make a big PR?
It was a big PR thing, and it was a huge boost to morale. They did not give the details in terms of taking off from a carrier, and they actually didn't release that till towards the end of the war, even though they never tried doing this again because basically they barely got off the deck. They even hid, actually, after the pilots were executed. They waited close to a year before releasing that to the American public, and that basically really enraged the American public and galvanized the war effort when they found out that happened.
How old was Doolittle when he took off?
About 46.
46?
He was in his mid-40s.
Yeah, he was not a young guy.
No, he was not a young guy at that point, yeah.
How did you get interested in
this? You know something, I belong to the Osher Institute I belong to the Osher Institute at RIT. It's a continuing learning center.
Oh, yeah.
And I was basically showing the movie 30 Seconds Over Tokyo and giving a background. And people had so many questions about the movie, I did a separate presentation and I put this together.
How accurate is the movie, 30 Seconds?
Incredibly accurate. Some of the corniest scenes you see in this movie where the guy sees his wife and he forgets he's in a wheelchair and he falls on his face, all that stuff really, really happened. It's one of the most accurate war movies that's ever made. Much more accurate than some recent movies like Saving Private Ryan, where there was a lot of publicity saying it was accurate. They weren't really as accurate as they said. But this one is one of the most accurate in history.
What was their primary target?
They had three cities they bombed, three different cities, and the planes were scattered among them. And as I said, they were primarily, they were exclusively military industrial targets. There was three planes that had to go to secondary targets. One plane basically couldn't reach the secondary or primary or secondary targets, and they got beneath what looked like a big factory to them. It had smokestacks and trains coming in it, and they just released their bombs on that. As a matter of fact, one of the women in the first time I gave this presentation was an elderly Japanese woman, and she was in school, a schoolgirl, and one of the Doolittle planes ripped right across the top of her school building, and everybody ran to the windows. And she said, after the raid, she said what everybody talked about, and the first thing when you talk to somebody about the raid, they asked you, is the emperor safe? That's what a concern there was around the emperor. Yeah. That's what a concern.
Were they pretty effective on their sights, on their targets?
Extremely accurate. Okay. Extremely accurate. I mean, the civilian casualties, it's tough to say exactly what they are because both the Americans and the Japanese were motivated to minimize the numbers. And the estimates range. I mean, most people say maybe about 200 to 300. Because they did this on a weekend. There were factories, so the factories really weren't going. They were mostly deserted. And most of the casualties happened when some of these fires spread to some of the surrounding neighborhoods because they were mostly wood. Okay? Okay, well, thank you very much for coming again.